Welcome to Glam Chat, the official podcast of South Australia's largest lifestyle news website, Glam Adelaide.
Hi everyone, Ben from Glam Adelaide here. Hey, just around the corner is the Spin-Off Festival, and it's going to be an amazing set list with a whole bunch of great artists and great bands performing this year on the 21st of July. One of those amazing bands is PNAU. And we are very lucky to be joined by Pete Mays, who is the guitarist of PNAU. Thanks for joining us, Pete.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
You are killing it at the moment. You're currently overseas. You've just launched your new single, Stars, which is brilliant. But the best thing of all is that you're about to come to the best state in Australia, South Australia. What are you most excited about performing at Spin-Off Festival?
I'm just excited to be back in Adelaide, to be honest, because it's been a while for us. Mm. It's been like, I think about 5 years. And obviously the pandemic and everything. So, you know, it's that put a bit of a dampener on everything. But yeah, I'm excited to, you know, go to a nice restaurant, bit of gauchos and see some Adelaide friends that we haven't seen in a while. But yeah, just to be back. We have a long-standing relationship with Adelaide and we've done a lot of work there, made a lot of music in Adelaide in the past when we lived in Sydney. And so it has a special place in our heart.
So you've collaborated with so many different amazing artists, Elton John, Dua Lipa, Troye Sivan, Khalid, and now most recently Ozuna and Bebe Rexha on Stars. What's it like collaborating with such a diverse number of people and a number of artists? How do you approach working with them?
Mostly approach it in the same way. If we're collaborating with someone who's just more of a songwriter, then it's different because you're just in the studio doing your thing. But if you're working with an artist, quite often they'll have their way that they like to work, especially if they're a singer. Mm. So it depends. With Khalid, we just come in with a bunch of beats and bunch of records that were kind of ready to go. And he'll go through like 4 or 5 of them in like an hour and sing his initial ideas over all of them. And then we'll just pick the best one and kind of expand upon that. He's incredibly fast. But it's different for everyone. Some people, like, I've never met Ozuna. That was all done remotely. So many things are done remotely now. I've never met Dua Lipa. That was all done remotely as well. Because sometimes you're just sending off a file, sending off a lyric sheet, and then you hear something back, you know, in the next couple of weeks. Or, you know, with BB, I went down to the studio and sat with her while she did her vocals, which is great. She's heaps of fun. But so it's different for everybody, I guess, is the answer.
Mm. One of the coolest collaborations and was in 2021 with Elton John. Obviously, Cold Heart kind of blew up. But that wasn't your first collaboration with Elton, was it? It was 2012 when you started. How did that come about? How did you form that relationship with Elton?
Probably in the mid-2000s, around 2005-ish. Can't remember exactly when. Elton was on tour in Australia and he found our album at a Virgin Megastore when they still existed. And he bought like 120 copies or something and sent them to all his friends. And he was having dinner with Toni Collette, the actress who he's a close friend of. And he was like, oh, I've got to meet these guys. And she was like, yeah, you should meet them. And Toni Collette has a band and we have the same agent. So it sort of came about through that. And we went to meet him. And then we eventually moved to the UK, which we were sort of, you know, thinking of doing anyway. And then he, in his company, kind of took up management of PNAU. And the great thing was how we came to make records with him was soon after that happened. He basically gave us all of his tapes from his whole career and just said, do whatever you want, make an album. And so we did. And that came out, around 2012, right when I moved to the States. And that was, you know, a big thing for us. Obviously, it was like, wow, Elton John's given us his whole career. It was incredible. So it was very daunting in many ways because we're like, oh my God, what if we, you know, mess this up? But such a great opportunity, of course. And so we took like several years to do that. And it was great. It was a different kind of thing. You know, it was really, we weren't really going for like big singles. It was a real album kind of listen. Whereas this time with Cold Heart, we wanted to have a big single. Because, you know, the music world has kind of changed. It's not so much about albums anymore. So, yeah, we've been with Elton for a long time now.
Mm. Yeah. And on that, like, how do you pick the songs that you're like, yeah, we want to work with this one. There's something in this. And that's not just with Elton. I mean, obviously you remix kind of Tame Impala, Lizzo. Like, what kind of goes, yeah, that's a song that we can make something out of?
It's all about the vocal because... I mean, with Elton, it's a bit different, especially with the first album, because most of the instrumental ideas we took from his records as well. But in general, with a remix, for instance, or with an artist that you are excited about, it's all about the vocal, really. They have an exciting voice, or they have exciting ideas, or just a different voice. You know, we love a character voice, something that's out of the ordinary that really stands out, especially within electronic music. If you put something really interesting texturally, vocally, over, you know, what electronic musicians normally do, I think that's quite often a very good combination.
And what I think is so amazing about your music is that even though you've collaborated with so many, as we've said, diverse artists, you can still hear that's a PNAU song, and it's got that kind of that musicality that's so unique to you guys. Has that evolved? Where has that come from?
Can't tell you. Because it just is what we do. I mean, that's very nice of you to say. I don't know. It just comes from, I guess it comes from the fact that we love dance music and we love electronic music and we've always listened to it. But we also love every type of music, really. And we really love melody. And in order to have great melody, a lot of the time you want to have great chords, and then you combine those two things together and then you've got a song. And so if you put that together with something you could dance to, then that's a song. There you go. But I don't know where it comes from. I think we just have a desire to, like, I've always wanted to create something that would be perfect for the clubs, but it seems like our music never ends up being that clubby, you know, like strictly clubby. So we kind of rely on other remixes a lot of the time to achieve that, you know, and to be really up on that, because it's not necessarily what we do all the time, going to clubs and stuff.
You said before how much the music industry has changed, but you've remained relevant. I mean, you've kind of adapted, and obviously, like, with TikTok and social media now, everything's kind of just like, as you said, albums kind of don't matter anymore, especially for the younger generation. It's all kind of like one song wonders. How have you kind of, how have you created that longevity for yourselves? How have you adapted?
Well, strangely enough, I think the longevity, I'm probably wrong, but I think the longevity comes from actually doing albums. Because I think it's a collection of songs from a time of your life. And you know, we've been doing this for a little while now, so there have been many times in our lives that we've put out music. So I think, really, I guess the longevity comes from actually just enjoying it, you know? If you don't enjoy doing music, it'll come out in your music, you know? I mean, to be honest, there's nothing else that I could do. You know, I wouldn't.
You're not going to go into accounting
if I was there. I'm not very good with numbers, but I don't know what I would do if there was some. I mean, I have other things that I like, but I don't know how I would ever, you know, pay the bills from anything else.
Yeah, and that enjoyment, I mean, you kind of started, this has all kind of been around your friendship with the Littlemores, with Nick and Sam, and I think Nick and yourself started playing music together when you were 12 or something, you know, in school. I mean, is that where that kind of passion, that's obviously, you were passionate about it and you shared that passion. Is that kind of, that's helped your evolvement?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it was interesting because Nick and I, first bonded when we were probably about 12, 13 over our love of the same kind of music, but we were both coming from a slightly different place. He came more from the world of industrial music, and I kind of came from the world of rave music and at the time. And we liked bands like Meat Beat Manifesto that combined the two. And it was also, it was a different time in electronic music where it wasn't so hyper genre focused. Mm. You know, it was just sort of more general, and styles and genres or subgenres were really being, it was the early days, they were still being formed. So there weren't so many rules, I guess. Not that I'd like to think there is rules, but there obviously are. Mm. But yeah, we've always bonded over music, and it's kept us going all this time. It's a great basis for a relationship. Obviously, we're really good friends outside of that, and we have a lot of other things we like to do, but the music is always there, you know, and it always has been.
That's brilliant. Hey, before we let you go, what is your favorite PNAU song?
Oh, I don't know.
Pick a favorite.
I mean, it depends where you are and in what setting. I mean, I kind of, it's funny because our shows tend to be pretty full on, pretty kind of banging, pretty, you know, almost techno at times. And I can't pick a favorite. It's really hard, but it depends what kind of mood you're in. If you want to hear, you know, if I'm just driving in the car, then I'll probably want to, my favorite changes every week because it's most of the time your favorite is the latest thing you're working on.
Yeah.
Because that's what you want to listen to all the time. But by the time something gets released, especially me, I've heard it so many times, like thousands and thousands of times, literally. So it's just, you know, it just ends up being, you've experienced it so many times. But when we get to play them live, that is where I have real fun with it because I'm listening to it in a totally different headspace, in a performative headspace, and in front of all these people, and I can see their reaction. And that's why I guess songs like Control Your Body from our last album are really fun because they're just kind of wild, acid, techno, house, ravey, fancy, you know? I guess my favorite ones are the ones that have a kind of punkiness to them, because that kind of energy is what Nick and I really thrive for. We often don't get there, but that's very exciting to us because we're kind of a festival band, and that just seems to fit in with the energy that we like to bring to the shows.
Mm. Well, I have no doubt that South Australia will bring a whole lot of energy that you can feed off of at the Spin-Off Festival. So we look forward to seeing you.
It always does. We look forward to playing for you at July
21.
Beautiful. There you go. I got it right for once. We look very excited to play for you guys. We'll see you all very soon.
This has been Glam Chat. For all the details mentioned in this episode and our ever-growing catalogue of podcast episodes, plus news about what's on in South Australia, hit up glamadelaide.com.au. Thanks for listening and join us next time.